Have you ever headed out on a journey or a trip with absolutely no plan whatsoever as to where you were going or what you were going to do when you got there?
If you're more of the free-spirited type, your favorite band in the 60s maybe was Steppenwolf, Born to Be Wild was your favorite song, LSD was your favorite drug of choice, and you somehow just wound up in San Francisco with no apparent idea on how you even got there, then this illustration, my friend, is not for you, because you are truly an exception to the rule. But for the rest of you guys, this is quite thought-provoking.
The fact is, most of us would not just take out on a journey with absolutely no destination in mind. I mean, that would be crazy. You would get up every morning, get your map, get your compass, walk all day long, and at the end of the day, you wouldn't know whether you had got closer or farther away from your intended destination.
And the truth is, each and every day, so many of us do this. We get up, we go to work, we come home, we crash, we get up the next day, and we do it all over again, not really knowing if we've come any closer or any further away to our destiny and our purpose for life. We go to bed empty, unfulfilled, and unaccomplished, completely wore out.
In this series, Discover Life, we're gonna help you discover your purpose for being on this planet. We're gonna give you 5 habits that are highly important to your success at fulfilling your purpose and your destiny.
This is gonna be a very powerful and practical series that's gonna help you to fast track your faith in Christ.
Join us on this journey as we discover life.
Everybody have their coffee? Everybody had donuts? Yeah, I was in the office trying to slam a donut before I came in here and got icing all over my pants. I was so frustrated. But it's all right. Jesus is still Lord, and I have heaven as my home, so it's all good. So glad you guys are here this morning. We are in this series called Discover Life. Everybody say Discover Life. How many of you want, it's a trick question, do not raise your hand. How many of you guys want an ordinary life? John 10 and 10, let's look at this. John 10 and 10 says, "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I," that's Jesus, "says, I have come that you may have," say life.
Life.
Say it like you believe it. Life.
Life.
"And that they may have," I have come that you may have life, and that they may have it, that they is you and me, "that they may have it more abundantly." Abundantly is above and beyond ordinary, right? God has an extraordinary life plan for us, not just here, but there as well. And this whole series is all about discovering life. Now, check this out. You were made for God, by God, and until you get that, your life will never make sense. It'll never make sense. You're going to just keep going in circles in life. You're going to be striving for things that will make you happy, and you will never find satisfaction. You will never find fulfillment in your life until you get linked up with your Creator, God. And that's what the series is all about. And so we talked that first week. We launched this intro service with the fact that really that God's desire is that you would know Him and that you would then make Him known. God desires to have relationship. Not just an ordinary relationship, a real and life-changing, contagious relationship with Him. That's what He wants. And once we learn to really know Him, then we have to take that cure for spiritual cancer, and we have to run like crazy and share it with everybody we know, because we love people, and we want to share the goodness of God with others around us.
That's right. So in this series, we've been looking at 5 different habits that will help you shape your life and live it on purpose. You know what's interesting? We heard something this week, and I had to write it down and add it into the message because it was so good. So I'm not going to claim I came up with it, although I think Brad was going to claim.
I wasn't going to claim that I came up with it, but I was going to insert it.
Nothing is original, right?
I'm talking. So I was going to insert it in my part of the outline, and she said, "Oh, that's good.
It goes with mine.
It goes with what I'm saying." So she changed the notes and put it in her part.
All right,
so go ahead and say it.
Listen to this. All right. It says this. People don't choose their future. People don't choose their future. They choose habits that shape their future. Think about that. You don't choose your future. You can have this dream in your mind of what you want your life to look like, but if you don't put habits in place to get you there, that's not what your life will look like. Your life is nothing more than a bunch of habits that shape your future. I'm going to tell you, yesterday I came into the house late last night, and my daughter is sitting at the table with all of her crafts, because she is just like the craft queen, okay? I mean, it's ridiculous. They're coming out our ears. And she was making this awesome book. And I walked up to it, and it's a book all about her habits and her schedule. And you've got to know she belongs to us. But I mean, every color highlighter she's got at 9 to 5, she's got everything she's doing. And I was like, that is so awesome, because you're 12 years old. And you're already establishing what your habits should be. And on one side, it said, my priorities in life. Now, she had one of them out of line because her DIY, which is do-it-yourself YouTube videos, was number one. And I was like, sweetheart, we need to switch that because Jesus has to be number one, which is what we're going to talk about. But in this series, we're looking at these habits. Now, we've gone through habits 1 through 3. That would be 3 right there. 1 through 3. So I'm going to pull them up, and we're going to go over them one more time. It says this. Habit number one, be in church every time the doors are open. That is every time you're given the opportunity to be in church. Be there. I want to tell you, it will shape your future. I know, because growing up, 9 months before I was ever born, my parents took me to church every time the doors were open. 9 months before my feet hit the floor, right? Then growing up, I mean, every time the doors were open, my parents had me in church. Now, as a kid, did I appreciate it? Not always, but as an adult, I am so thankful. I'm so thankful that my parents established that habit in my life, because it kept me from doing some dumb things in my life, kept me on the right path. Habit number two is connect with God's people. How many of you love one another? I'm serious.
That was slow and undecided.
Like, they're like.
That was so. You should have seen some of the face.
They're like. Some of you, that's your spouse on the other side of you that you're looking at.
Because she's sitting next to me, I guess I better raise my hand. It's the polite Christian thing to do.
Well, whether you like the person next to you or not, God wants you to connect with one another
and
have relationship together.
Long ride home, and you only live 5 minutes. That's crazy.
It can be kind of rough. Woo. It can be rough. All right, so we believe that you connect best with God on Sunday morning and connect with others on Wednesday night. Come out and join us in life groups.
Right, and so last week we covered this habit, grow. All right, this is habit number 3. And we covered some really cool things. How many of you guys have decided to jump on board with some of these habits, right, for growth? That's wonderful. I'm glad we're making such an impact in your life. So, the Word of God. We talked about studying God's Word. We talked about a private time of worship, right, every morning. Making God first and spending that time studying His Word, that time where you're worshiping, you're engaging with God, and then that time where you're linked up, especially if you're married, you're linked up with your spouse in prayer, and men, you're praying over your wife, you're being the man in your home, the pastor, the provider, the protector, and you're praying over her and over your family. And then, of course, we also talked about fasting, which I want to also remind you that our monthly fast comes this next week. It's going to start on Wednesday at noon. We're going to do the same thing for 3 days, and we're going to pull it together Saturday at noon. So you definitely want to jump on board for that. How many of you guys are ready? You're excited to jump in this go-around for fasting? Raise your hand.
You're not quite as excited as you should be, all right?
We'll see.
It's life change.
So I tricked you, see, because the Bible says you're not supposed to brag or boast about your fasting before men. And so y'all need to pray, sinners. So,
they're also supposed to follow their leader.
I'm serious. Prideful people. No, I want to tell you, this Wednesday, jump on board. Let's pull together as a family, as the body of Christ, and let's believe God to move mountains, not only in our lives, but really more importantly, in the lives of the ones we love in this community, that God would draw people from every direction, that they would be set free in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're about to see God move mountains. I'm excited. Okay, and then Misty launched that 15-minute challenge. Just take 15 minutes, we told you. Just 15 minutes. I don't have enough hands. But if I had one more hand, 15 minutes every morning, all right? 5 minutes in that your time of the Word. 5 minutes in that time of private devotion and worship to God. And then 5 minutes of prayer. Who doesn't have five minutes per category? 15 minutes to put God first. Do it. I'm telling you, it's going to change your life.
All right, so today we're going to jump into habit number 4, but don't throw it on the screen. Before we tell you what habit number 4 is, we're going to lay some groundwork, all right? We can't really build if we don't have a foundation. So I want to ask you guys, how many ever feel like life is just a little more than you can handle? just a little more than you can handle.
I was a little bit more confident than, do you love the person sitting next to you?
Perhaps that's why your life could be a little chaotic, honestly. You need to have some love. But, you know, we go through these things in life. We have tragedy. We have ups and downs. We have financial situations. We have relational situations. And so life can get overwhelming at times. And, you know, sometimes you look at people's life and it just looks like this. I mean, their life, and maybe you feel like this. You just feel like your life is like a roller coaster. You know, if things are going good, how many, don't raise your hand, all right? Do not. I'm just warning you.
Aren't you glad that you have pastors that prep you?
Yeah, we're not trying to embarrass you.
We're not trying to trick you.
All right. If you notice people, maybe this is you, maybe it's not. When things are going good, man, they are up here. Woo! Life is good. They're all smiles. I got a new outfit. Life's good. Got a bonus at work. You know, my husband's out of town. No, whatever. Just kidding. You're all excited because everything's going good. But then the second something starts to go a little not so wonderful, they're just, man, life stinks, you know? And they're just nasty and negative, and you're like, man, I'm going to avoid them. That's what I'm talking about this roller coaster life. Do you know that's not the life God actually intends us to live? How many of you would like to live a life that no matter what came your way, tragedy, devastation, frustration, financial issues, relational issues, you could walk it out in peace, steady? Do you know that that is what God actually wants for your life? When you truly discover life, even though you go through ups and downs, because listen, Jesus already told us we would go through ups and downs. In his word, he said, hey, in this life, you will have troubles. You will have tribulation. But guess what? Be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. You're not going to live in this life forever. Did you know this life is only temporary? This is just my temporary home. So when we go through ups and downs, we don't have to emotionally be controlled. We can allow the peace of God to rule in our life. But only if we're doing one thing. Only if we have put God first. See, here's the difference. A lot of times we like to categorize life with all these beautiful little categories. And maybe God's one of them, and that's awesome. But God doesn't want to just be one of your many categories. He wants to be in the center of every one of them. In the center. So when you have relational problems, you go to God. When you have financial problems, you go to God. When you have tragedy, you go to God. You put God first in everything. And when you do, all of a sudden, you become this stable, steady person that says, hey, God's got it. Do I understand? Absolutely not, and I will not pretend to. But God's got it, and I'm going to walk it out in peace.
All right, so today, are you guys ready for habit number 4? All right. So you're only as great as the habits you have. Remember, what we're trying to do is we are trying to help you to develop a spiritual foundation for your life that God can build something on. Right. You would never, ever step out and build a house on a poor foundation. If you want your marriage to be a success, if you want your children to be a success, if you want to be a success as a parent, if you want to be a success at anything you put your hands to, you have got to build a spiritual foundation of the right habits, and that is what we're giving you in this series. So today, what we're talking about, you can go ahead and put the slide up, it's returning to God your first. Returning to God your first. Everybody say first. So what are we talking about here with returning to God our first? Let's look at Exodus 20 and verse 3. How many of you guys are familiar with the Ten Commandments? You ever heard of the Ten Commandments? Raise your hand. All right. Commandment number 1 says this. You must not have any other God but me. So what God, just this is a test and a quick recap of the scripture we just read. What God does our God want you to put before him? No other God. So what he's saying is here is, I want to be what? First. I want to be first in your life. Is he saying I want to be second? Third? Last? A thought? A dream? No. He wants to be what? First. God wants to be first in our lives. Perfect case in point. Flip the page and the thing blows up and I can't read a word. Okay. Psalm 24 and verse 1. Look at this. I love this scripture. It says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all its people belong to him. So what belongs to God? Everything. The clothes on your back, the car you drove here, this building, right? The food that you put in your mouths, everything belongs to God. What I want you to do for the remainder of this message is I want you to do something that will help you to maximize your ability to receive what God wants you to receive from this. I want you to see this message from God's perspective, okay? Pretend just for a second. I know this is hard to imagine, but you're God. Oh, man, how the world would be different, and that's why I'm not God, right? But imagine that you're God just for a second. You created humanity, all these people. You created the earth and everything in it, right? It all belongs to you. The people belong to you, but they have a free will that you've given them to make up their own mind, make up their own decisions, choose whom they will serve, right? Think about it from this perspective. God owns it all. So when we look at it from this perspective and we look that God wants to be first in our lives, we realize that we have an obligation, we have a responsibility, and that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to take you into a really cool story about this widow woman, all right? Now, where she was living in this time frame, they were going through a massive, massive drought, okay? Just imagine if there hadn't been any rain for months and months and months. Some believe that it had been about 6 months when this happened. They were about 6 months into what was probably going to be a 3.5-year drought, all right? Imagine the implications that we would experience with no water and no rain. What would happen? Everything would dry up. The animals would begin to die. We would run out of food, and we would certainly run out of water. I want to read this passage to you in 1 Kings 17, verse 7 through 16, and it says this. But after a while, the brook dried up, for there was no rainfall anywhere in the land. Then the Lord said to Elijah, Elijah was a prophet of God, he said, go and live in the village of Zarephath near the city of Sidon. I have instructed a widow there to feed you. So he went to Zarephath, and as he arrived at the gates of the village, he saw a widow gathering sticks, all right? Now, mind you, she was doing all that she could do in the moment. All right, considering her circumstances, considering her situation, she was doing all she knew to do. She was doing her very, very best, all right? And he asked her, he said, would you please bring me a little water in a cup? And as she was going to get it, he called to her again, and he said, bring me a bite of bread, too. Man, how demanding this guy is. This stranger comes from out of nowhere and asks this woman that he doesn't even know to get him a cup of water and make him some bread. And she says to him, I swear by the Lord your God that I don't have a single piece of bread in my house. All right? Here's the point I want to bring out just right from the get-go. God knows your situation. God knows exactly what you are going through right now. He knows how much is in your account. He knows how much food is in the cupboard. He knows what's coming down the pike. He knows what's not coming down the pike. He knows exactly what you're going through, mentally, physically, spiritually. He knows every square inch of your body. He knows every fiber, every cell, every molecule. He knows you inside and out. He knows way more about you and your situation than you do. So why so many times do we question God and say to ourselves, he's not even listening. He doesn't understand. He's so far from me. I'm telling you, in those moments, he's closer than you realize. He's closer than you can ever possibly imagine. Let me read this next part. It says here, and I have only a handful of flour left in the jar and a little cooking oil in the bottom of the jug. I was just gathering a few sticks to cook this last meal. Listen to this. And then my son and I will die. See, they were only 6 months into a 3.5-year drought, and she had already determined in her mind, we are good as dead. We've run out of food. We've run out of water. Now my son and I, we're just going to die, all right? Only 6 months. Verse 13, but Elijah said to her, don't be afraid. Didn't we sing about that just a little bit ago? Don't be afraid. No, I think that's
an
80s song. To let them know your true color shining. Sorry. Who is that? Cyndi Lauper.
Wow.
She's a wild one. Where was I? That's good stuff. Oh.
ADD
don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. How can that not come in your head when you say that? Go ahead and do just what you've said. But listen, but make a little bread for me first. Are you serious? I don't have any food. I don't have hardly any water. I have just a little teeny little bit. My son and I are going to have our last meal. We are about to die. And you want me to make you some bread. You want me to make you supper. And I'm about, this is my last meal, man. Come on, be sensitive here. He says, and I love this, and if you're willing to write in your Bible, and I hope it's a notebook, I hope it's a workbook. It says, but make me a little bread, what? What's the word? First. He's God's man, sent by God, from God, for that hour, for her situation. Why was Elijah there? Was he there for him? No! He was there, sent by God, for who? For her! So why does he say, in as a representation of God, make me first? He was representing God, and he said, make me first. Even though I know you think you're about to die, I know you're looking at your situation, and you're looking at your situation with human eyes, and you are saying that this is impossible for me to survive. But God is saying, listen, don't trust your gut, all right? Don't trust your heart, because the Bible says the heart above all things is what? Deceitful. Listen, put God first.
That's right. And you know what is interesting about this is every single day of our life, we have the same opportunity that the widow had. God puts us to the test all the time to want to know, will you put me first, or will you put me second, or third, or last, or not at all? Let's pick up where he left off. It says this. Whoa, we're trying to get used to using these iPads and it's messing me up. Then use what's left to prepare a little meal for me and my son. For this is what the Lord God says. There will always be enough flour and oil left in your containers until the time when the Lord sends rain and the crops grow again. How many years was it going to be before this thing ended? Do you remember what Brad said? 3.5 years. Our front row, man, they're used to being in school. They got it. 3.5 years. They're 6 months in, and God says, look, if you put me first, I know that the last of your flour and oil are in your containers right now, but I will sustain them for the next 3 years. There's no crops. There's not going to be any water, but I'm going to sustain your supply so long as you put me first. Do you know what he's about to do in her life? It's what we call a miracle. She's about to experience a miracle, but she has a decision to make. She has to put God first. You go on to verse 15 and it says this. So she did as Elijah said. And she said, and Elijah and her family, they continued to eat for many days. There was always enough flour and olive oil left in the containers, just as the Lord had promised through Elijah. Was there always enough left? Yes. 3 years. 3 years. Every time she would go back to make a little bit of a pancake or a biscuit, or every time she went to go knead some bread, she reached in for her flour and the container was never empty. Do you know that she probably for the next 3 years every time was like, is it really going to be there? Like, is it really, really going to be there? A year goes by. Is it still going to be there? 2 years goes by. 3 years goes by. All because she chose to put God first in the test. I want to tell you that throughout your life, you have an opportunity to put God first in every area. And when you do, what you're doing is you're saying, God, I invite you into that area of my life. Brad and I are so adamant about couples praying together. Let me tell you why. All right? Every day of our life, we pray together. Every single day. There's not a day that goes by that we don't join hands and pray. Why? Because the enemy wants to steal, kill, and destroy your marriage. Why? So he can destroy your family. Why? So he can mess with your kids. Why? So he can destroy the church. All right? Nick, that's, man, I'm getting ready to preach a marriage
series. Go ahead
series.
Right now and just give a plug.
Yeah, let's do that.
Go ahead.
Okay.
You want me to do it?
We're passionate about marriage. On February 12th, we're getting ready to launch a series called Happily Ever After. We're going to teach you as single people who to be looking for and how to know how to find your mate. And if you are married, we are going to teach you how to have a real marriage that God intended for you, because so many people are not doing it. They're not living it. I don't have time
to
preach it. They're surviving.
But their marriage is not thriving.
That's right.
And that's not God's will. God wants you to thrive in your marriage. It's still your point.
That's right. I know. I was just going to
drink while
you're talking.
Hey,
all
we're
right,
going to do. No, this is good. We're going to do something.
Hold on. Let me go. Okay.
You don't understand.
Awesome.
So this next deal coming into February, it's not going to be a series, if you will. I mean, it is, but it's not. It's going to be a Sunday morning conference. So come ready to take notes.
That's
How many of you guys like conferences? How many conference junkies do we have? Oh, man.
Yes, right here.
Telling you what.
And if you don't, you're going to like this one.
And don't tune this out if you're single, because this is for you. Don't tune it out if you're married. This is definitely for you, all right? And if you've been divorced, if you've experienced that tragedy, this is really, really, really for you. It's for everybody, even kids.
Yeah.
If you'll pay attention to the biblical principles that we're going to share with you in this Sunday morning conference, I'm telling you guys, it will completely light up your world as to what God really wants for marriage and really
right.
what marriage is truly made of.
That's, right.
That's what this conference is about. It's the first time we've ever done it, really.
Absolutely.
Sunday morning conference. It's awesome.
So let's go back to where we were. If you want God to be first, you have to invite him to be first in that area. So every day we pray together because we want God to be first in our marriage. Every day we pray with our children. We want God to be first in our parenting. Every single day when God has brought an increase into our home, all right, whether it's a birthday present, whether it's a paycheck, whether it's whatever it is, it makes no difference. We sell a puppy, we sell a cow, we sell a kid. It doesn't matter. Wherever we get an increase, we make sure that we give
God our first. We're just going to put God first.
First, yeah. Right? All right.
How
we're
much
gonna
do
put
kids go for these days anyway?
I don't know. Probably not nearly enough.
Wonder what ours are worth.
Kids cost a lot. All right. Listen to me. When you do that, when you give God back the first portion that he asked for, and what does he ask for? You can go all through the Old Testament and into the New, and God says, I want the tenth. I want the first ten. And he doesn't say, pay all your bills, make yourself and your son a pancake, make yourself a biscuit, and then give Elijah what's left. No, he says, I want to be first. Why? Because it's just a representation of your heart. Where is your heart at? See, does God need your money? No. The Bible says he owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. All right? But what God wants is your heart. My money is attached to my heart, and there's a string that attaches it. Well, I don't have a wallet, but Brad would say to his wallet, all right? Mine's in my purse in the other
room. The reason
she's
saying that is because that was on my point to say that.
It was not.
Yeah.
There is nothing
right
on your
wallet,
point right
my heart,
there.
But you get the point.
But
quit
listen.
Taking my stuff. It's good.
Whatever.
That'll preach.
Whatever. But when you do that, you invite God to be first in your finances. I want to tell you a quick story. We could tell you a million, all right? A million different stories of how God has done this in our life. But just this December, Brad and I were going through some issues with our car. Like the car was kind of having problems. You guys know we drive a sweet minivan. Well, let me tell you why we drive a sweet minivan. Because we are adamant about getting out of debt, all right? We are of the opinion that you can be debt-free, and we've been working hard for the last 2 years to get completely out of debt, all right? We came here without debt when we came to plant this church, and we allowed ourselves to get into debt. We had the mindset that, hey, we need to do this. So the van was the very next thing to be paid off, and every day we pray, God, whatever the debt is, God, help us pay off the van every single day. Well, in December... it would have been November, right before, it was right at Thanksgiving. The transmission goes out of the van, and I remember very clearly because Black Friday is the day after Thanksgiving, and that's my Christmas shopping day. But the transmission went out right before that. And we thought for sure, like, no, there's no way, it's really the transmission. So we took it and got, like, transmission fluid and put in there, and we're like, that's going to fix it. Yeah, no. It was like, and I'm like... This is for real. Like, this is like a $1,500 jobby right here. This
work.
Is insane. This is not happening to us right before Christmas, and we're trying to pay off the van, right? So we had an opportunity in that moment to put God first in our attitude. In that moment, I'm not kidding you, okay? This was immediately, my mind goes back to the Israelite. They wandered for 40 years, and that's another message, but they did because they grumbled and they complained. And I just said, okay, God. For whatever reason, you're going to let our transmission go out. Go ahead. Like, we want to pay it off, but now we'll put a new transmission in. Listen, we didn't plan on putting a transmission in right before Christmas, okay? We take it into the shop. We had to have it towed, by the way. So we tow it. We pay the tower. It goes over. They said $2,600. We're like, what? $2,600? You got to be kidding me. Like, let's go Fred and Wilma. You know what I mean? Cut out the bottom, and we'll do it with our feet. We got four kids. I got four, by the way, four kids. We're like, wow, well, let's get a second opinion. We had it towed from there on to Joplin. Joplin said they would do it for two, a guy in Joplin. So $2,000. Now, back up. Remember, this is the day before Black Friday. This is my traditional. Is it not tradition?
It's tradition.
We've been doing it since I was like 12. Yeah. We go shopping on Black Friday, and when Brad married into my family, it's like, that's what I do. Like, I'm sorry. Like, we're going to go all night long. And so...
Honey, I'm going to keep you up all night.
Yes! I'll buy you a coffee.
I'll get you coffee,
but
and
no
I'll
food.
Even feed you.
No, I don't buy you food.
Yes, you do.
What?
You did once.
I packed granola bars, dude.
Granola bars, snacks.
All right.
And stay up all night long and shop.
That's right.
How about that?
Fun.
I'm like, oh, you know, I'm all in.
But
this
listen...
Great.
But when you don't have the money for your transmission, guess what? That puts a little halt on Christmas, all right? So there was going to be no shopping, and I had to tell myself right here in my little brain, you're not going to have a bad attitude about this. You're absolutely not going to have a bad attitude. You go to Thanksgiving with your family. You come home. You make the best of it with your kids. We'll do something fun on Black Friday. You're not going to be cranky because you don't get to go shopping. And if we don't have Christmas, we're more blessed than half the, you know, 97% of the entire world. So we're going to get over it. So we waited like 2 weeks. We get the bill. And 2 days before the bill was going to come, we did not have the $2,000 we needed to pay for that car. All right? We did not have it because every single penny coming in over our needs was going straight to debt. So we did not have this big savings account. 2 days before the bill comes in, guess what comes in? A huge blessing comes in, and we got an extra $2,000 right before the bill was due. So we were like, thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad I did not complain. And so we write the check, and we go get that sweet silver minivan, and we bring it home, and we're like,
yeah, we're back in business.
Now here we go, all right? But we didn't have Christmas still. And then another $1,000 comes in unexpectedly right before Christmas. So we were able to do Christmas without any hiccups. So Brad had to still take a Friday and shop all day.
Yeah.
For hours until midnight.
Tradition.
And we got Christmas. All right? But the reason I tell you this story is because we were putting God first all along in our tithe. Always. Always. God, you're first. And so when this transmission went out, I didn't have to wonder who was going to pay for it. Because I'm doing what I always do. We go to work every day. We take care of what God has given us, and we put God first in our tithe. So we were saying, God, your word says that you're my provider and you're my protector, so you're going to have to pay this bill. And here it is. And guess what? Did he give it to us 2 months before we needed it? No. 1 day before the van needed to be picked up, he gave us the $2,000. 1 week before Christmas, we had money for Christmas, all right? But I'm telling you that my God is so good that we went on past it and we're like, we're set back a little bit, but we're going to get back on track and get that sucker paid off. We paid the van off this week. Totally paid it off. And put a new transmission in it. My God is good. Why? Because he says, put me first. Put me to the test. And when you do, you don't have to wonder who's going to take care of you. My God will take care of every single one of your needs, just like he did the little widow. Why? Because he says, test me. Put me to the test, and you see if I won't open up the windows of heaven and pour down a blessing so much you can't even contain it. It will blow your mind, guys. I'm telling you, it will blow your mind. If you've never done that, you can then go to God and say, God, you're my provider. I've done what you've asked me to do. I put you first in my giving. I put you first in my marriage. I put you first in my parenting. God, I put you first. Can you say it? I put you first. I put you first.
Amen. Guys, listen. I know that the last place you want to hear about money is in the church, because there have been so many people in the church that have abused what God has meant for something to be so good and so holy, with such purpose to touch your lives and use you with a purpose to bless him and his kingdom. And I know it's tough to hear these kind of things, because many people, if you've not been in church, you immediately start putting up these walls. And you're like, no, you're not seriously going to tell me to give more money so this church can do more things. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Why? Because it's not about your money. It's not about your money. It's about your heart. It's a heart condition. It's a heart thing. God is saying, have you really, truly put me first? Have you really positioned yourself for me to bless you and bless your life and be able to bless those around you? Let me give you the two reasons why we give or return, I should say. And we say return. We don't say give. We say return because it's not ours to begin with. It's all God's. So when we return our tithe, the tenth of our income to God, and I'll just have you say, Misty and I don't say this boastfully, but it's just, we give way more than that. We give way more than 10%. Because the 10% is what's expected of him in obedience from us to him. What we give above that, God says, wow, it's like extra credit. I didn't ask you for this. You're just doing it because you love me and you want to bless me and you want to bless my kingdom. So the first part of it is it's obedience. It's saying, God, you own it all. These clothes are yours. The car is yours. The house is yours. Everything is yours. When that paycheck comes in the mail or however you get your check, the first thing that we do is we return our tithe to God right off the top. The first thing we do. Why do we do that? Because we want God to be first in our finances. We want to invite God's involvement in our finances. We want our finances to be blessed, right? We want God to bless not only our finances, but our home and our children and our health and our marriage, our church, everything. We want to invite God to be first. So the first thing is it's about obedience. Why? Why do we give? Because God says, give back. God says, return it. The second part is it's about his kingdom. You know, God gave the church as this one plan A, this one tool, right, to make him known. There's this one plan that God gave humanity to bring in all of those who don't have that real and life-changing relationship with him to his kingdom, into his kingdom and to his throne. And it's called the local church, going out and making him known. You know, everything that we do here costs money. And it was God's plan. God ordained it that way, that not only would we give it in obedience, but then the money that we give, he doesn't need it, but his kingdom needs it. He uses those resources, right, to build buildings and to hire staff and to pay the electric bills and to minister to the community. Realize, and you may not know this, I think it's so cool, that God put within our hearts as pastors years ago towards the beginning of this church plant that the church itself would tithe out and that we would give 10% of the church's monthly income. And that we would give it to such organizations like Gideon's International, which is responsible for distributing millions and millions and millions of scriptures all around the world. They're in way over 200 countries. How many of you guys have ever been to a hotel and you pull the drawer open, there's a Bible sitting there? That's because of many churches like this one that every single month is sending a check so that we can buy Bibles, so that we can send out those volunteers, those Gideons, to distribute Bibles on school campuses and in hotel rooms and all around the world. They're going on missions trips into foreign countries, and they're distributing Bibles all around the world. And this church is part of that every month. This church supports orphanages in Haiti and South America. This church supports locally the Abundant Blessing Center, which ministers to women that are in crisis. Right? We send money out to the Grove Christian Help Center, which goes to feed hungry families that are in need in Delaware County and surrounding areas. That money goes to clothe families. I'm telling you, we are blessed so that we can be a blessing. We're blessed so that God can flow through us like conduit so that we can be a blessing to others. And what you'll find out in your life, it's so crazy because it mathematically doesn't make sense. But the more we give of ourselves, when God blesses us with a spirit of generosity, we give and give and give. God says, hey, I can trust that person right there and I can flow through them to make my name great in all the land and bring people to myself. That's what God does. That's what this church is all about. We're a giving church. We realize that God can be glorified through it all. So when we return the tithe to God, that's what begins to happen. So for those of you that have not made that decision in your life, you've not stepped out, right, to operate in that habit, I'm telling you right now as your pastor, I love you, and you are missing something so huge. I promise you from the bottom of my heart, we're not saying this because we want the giving to go up. Do we want the giving to go up as pastors? Yeah, we want it to go up. But that's not for us personally. Our salary is set. We're not going to make any more money as pastors. So if you've got that in your head, that's just the enemy working on your mind. We make no more money the more this church gives. Here's what happens. God is glorified. God does something in your heart, right? And then we're able to do more as a church and reach more people. I'm so excited. We've been meeting with, we have found a design team and a construction company to build this next building. We are pumped, guys. We are pumped, excited. We're going to be bringing you guys some information. It's going to take them 90 to 120 days to, and I hadn't even planned on working this in, I'm just, because it just happened. So within a 90 to 120 days, we should have some site plans for everything that we foresee God doing. And it's going to be so exciting. And as we get that information, we'll be sharing it with you. But if I want to challenge you today, all right, we're talking about habits, all right? And we're building a foundation that God can build a life on, all right? Unless the Lord builds the house, those who labor, labor in vain. You try to build your life your way, and it's not going to work. But you build it God's way, and God will do amazing things in your life, in your marriage, and in your home. So today we're talking about returning the tithe to God. Can we show the video now, or do you want to wait? You want to wait later? It's not in the outline. I'm sorry. Later? Okay. I get so excited. Hey, this video is going to be really good, guys. It's going to bless you. Malachi chapter 3. I want to pull this up as we close today. This is good. This is good. Malachi chapter 3. Let me give some background to what's happening. So basically, you remember how Misty opened up this service, opened up this message, and she was talking about how many times have you've just been beating your head up against a wall, and it's like, it's not, my life's not coming together, it's not making sense, nothing's working out. That's what this country was experiencing. And they went to God and basically said, they're crying out to God and like, God, why? Why is all of this happening to us? Why are we not blessed? Why are we not experiencing your favor in our lives? And this is how God responds to them. It's so heavy. It is so very, very heavy, but we got to pay attention to this. He says, you are under a curse, for the whole nation has been cheating me. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse so that there will be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord of Heaven's army, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you won't have enough room to take it in. He says, try it. Put me to the, what? Test. The only place in Scripture where God says it's okay to test him. All other places, God says, you shall not test or tempt the Lord your God. That was a sure way for God to just lay down his fury on his people back then when they tested him. But God says, in this, I want you to test me. Put me first in your finances. Put me first in your life, and you just watch and see what I do. Just watch and see what I do. I want to challenge those of you today, if you've not made a decision to make that a part of your habits, right, every week, to return to God the tenth, I'm telling you, literally, right, we are asking for a curse on our lives. You're thinking, wow, Brad, I've come to be inspired today, and you're telling me I'm cursed. Wow, Pastor. Hey, thank God you have a pastor who loves you, right? And who's willing to be honest and share the word of God with you, and who doesn't walk in fear, right, that I need to sugarcoat anything or preach a shallow gospel that Paul didn't preach. I'm going to tell you just like the word of God says it. And you know what? If you say to yourself, Pastor, that's not for me. That tithing thing is not for me. Hey, so be it. I love you anyway, right? And eventually, I promise you, you're going to realize that God's trying to get your attention. He's trying to prove himself to you, right? I want you to stand up today. I want to pray with you. I want to pray with you today. Misty, would you lead us?
If you would just bow your heads and close your eyes this morning. You know, before you can even consider returning to God what's his, God wants to be first in your heart.
Yes.
The way you make him first in your heart is by simply inviting him in. When you invite him in, you're not just saying, Jesus, come and live in my heart, but you're saying, Jesus, come and live and rule and reign and be number one in my life. Above everything else, I want your will. I want your purpose because you created me. I don't want my own. I don't want to live for me. I don't want to just do what I want to do. But God, when I invite you into my heart, I want to do what you want me to do. You make him first. When you do that, it is the first step to watching your life begin to take shape. It's the first step to really discovering what real living is all about. Because living for yourself, there's no fulfillment in that. And without even realizing it, when you don't live for God, you're by default living for yourself. And you're missing out on the most incredible relationship that you were created to have, and that is a relationship with Almighty God. This morning, I want to invite you to have that real relationship with Jesus, to make Him first in your life, to surrender everything to Him. If you're here today and you would say, Misty, I want what you're talking about. I want that real relationship with God. I want to make Him first. I may have even invited Him into my life in the past, but He is definitely not first, and I want God first in my life. If that's you, right now, I want you to just throw your hand in the air, and we're going to pray with you this morning. Amen. I see your hand. Amen. 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 Thank you, Jesus. You want God first in your life. Church, will you pray together with me as we invite Jesus to be the Lord of our life? Father God, I love you.
Father God, I love you.
I ask that you would come into my heart.
I ask that you would come into my heart.
That you would forgive me of my sins.
That you would forgive me of my sins.
That you would rule and reign in my life.
That you would rule and reign in my life.
I want you to be first.
I want you to be first.
I want to have a real relationship with you.
I want to have a real relationship with you.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Will you be seated for a moment?
Hello, my name is Mason Hendricks, and I started attending Mountain Movers in January 2016. So I was sitting in the sanctuary, and I had just graduated, getting ready to go to college. I had no money. I didn't have a job because I played sports, and I mean, I didn't want a job. Nobody wants a job. I mean, come on. But anyways, I had no money. I had, I think, $10 in my pocket. Or in my wallet, and I had a 5 and 5 ones. I was like, you know what, a dollar's not that much. I'm just gonna put a dollar in. So I put a dollar in, and I kinda hit it. I put it in my palm, and I just, whenever I grabbed the bucket, I dropped it. So nobody really knew. Cause, I mean, I don't know why. But anyways, so the next Sunday comes, and I'd spent a dollar of that $10, so I ended up having $8, and I was like, yeah, you know, I'll just put another dollar in, maybe God will bless me this week or something. So I kind of did the same thing. I hit it and passed it on. So a few weeks go by, nothing really happened. I kind of forgotten about it, and my aunt, she gave me this card, and I was reading it, and it said something about how she was praying and God told her to bless me. And so there's two $100 bills in there. And, you know, I was like, wow, she's really nice. Like, why would she give me $200? So I didn't think much of it. And I went on with the day. And about 11 o'clock at night, I got home back to my dad's house. And I took the card, it was this card right here, and I just laid it. I was going to put it down where I put my keys in my wallet, and it hit me. I was like, wait a minute. So I read the card again, and she said that it was from God. It wasn't from her at all. God told her to give me that. And I just got chills because I gave two $1 bills, and in this card there's two $100 bills. And, you know, in the Bible, I don't know exactly where, but it says that He will repay you in like 100-fold. And that's what He repaid me. And that was just an awesome blessing. I just sat there in awe. Before I started attending Mountain Movers Church, tithing, I mean, I've always heard about it, and I've always heard people talk about it and that you're supposed to. And it was always like drilled in my head that you're supposed to. I never really known why until I started attending Mountain Movers. I decided to start tithing because, well, I'd heard a lot of Brandy. She talked about it, and just people talking about it up on the stage. And now that I'm older, I really started to realize that I need to, because it's not my money. Nothing on this earth is ours. It's all His. So I was like, this is His. If He wants to bless me now, He can bless me now, but I know that He's going to bless me no matter what. If you're watching, I highly recommend you test God and put your tithe, give back to Him what's His, because it took a few weeks for Him to bless me, and I kind of forgot about it. So He will, no matter, maybe it'll be money, maybe it'll be something else, but no matter what, He's going to bless you.
Hey, thanks for joining us today. We sincerely hope the message impacted your life. Stay connected with us by following us online, or you can find us on Facebook. If you would like to partner with us financially, we have a few easy ways to give. You can text your giving to 77977 and simply type in MMC and follow the prompts. Or you could find us online at www.mountainmoverschurch.org and click the Give Now tab. Or you could simply mail your giving in to 24000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma 74344. We are a church leading people into a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ that is contagious. We look forward to seeing you next week.